I'm Bob. I'm Paul Brewster, TRPC, senior planner, and I'll just call on folks. If you could just then introduce yourselves. And just so you know, we're recording this meeting just so that if there are DRC members who miss it, we can share the link, and also we'll this provides us an audio transcript for our note-taking. So first up, Casey.
Hi folks, I'm Casey Mock. I work with Paul at TRPC and just helping to assist on this project. Sherry?
Good morning, everyone. Sherry Nevin with Thurston County Emergency Management.
Oh, Sandy.
Sandy Ecker, Thurston County Emergency Management.
Brian?
Brian Hurley with Tumwater.
Ed?
Ed Taylor, the City of Lacey Emergency Management Safety Coordinator.
And Todd?
Todd Carson, City of Olympia Emergency Management.
Todd, is Patrick joining us today or is it just you?
I think it's just me, Paul.
Okay, thank you. Sarah, welcome.
Hi, thank you. Good morning. Sarah Williams, City of Yelm.
And Sarah, just you today from Yelm?
Correct.
Great. Now, let me see. Make sure I'm not missing any DRC members. And we have a guest speaker today, Quinn.
Hey, good morning, everyone. My name is Quinn Butler. I'm with the Washington State Emergency Management Division, and I'm a recovery planning program manager. Happy to be here.
Okay, I think I got everybody. Let me know if I missed anybody. All right, so for today's meeting, just a quick share of our, make sure I'm sharing the right screen. Doesn't look like I am. Okay, for today's agenda, Quinn is going to give us an overview of the Washington Restoration Framework. This Quinn's a great resource, as he was really the principal behind shaping the Washington's recovery framework. And I'd just say seize this opportunity today to ask questions about the state's role with disaster recovery and how they assist local agencies, and ask questions about how our local recovery framework can integrate in with the state's framework. And then we've sent out to you an advanced draft copy of your charter. And so we're looking for your input and looking for your action today to approve that. And then I'm going to give an overview of the DRC's work plan and priorities for now through the end of July. So any questions before we get started? Okay. Quinn, does Quinn have hosting privileges to share his screen?
He should.
Let me check. Yes, are we ready to get going?
Yeah, take it away, Quinn.
All right, it's gonna take me a minute to figure out which screen to share and make sure I get it into presentation mode. I wonder if I do this. Now, are you seeing just the presentation, or are you also seeing my notes?
We're now seeing your presentation.
Perfect. Wow. All right. Got it on my first try. Okay. Hey, thanks everyone. Thanks so much for inviting me to be here today. I might turn my camera off if the bandwidth ends up slowing down. It's so hit or miss. Sometimes I don't have internet issues for a week or two, and sometimes it'll just cut out. So stick with me if my internet drops. Hopefully it does not. During this presentation, please stop me at any time. Just as a small enough group, you can unmute and just talk over me or raise your hand, whatever works best. It's kind of hard to see the chat, so I'll ask Casey and Paul to help me out if any questions come in the chat. But we don't have to hold questions to the end. If there's something that you have a question on as I move through this, then please be sure to stop me. So as I said in my intro, my name is Quinn Butler. I'm the Recovery Planning Program Manager at Washington EMD. Been working there for a little over 4.5 years now. And the bulk of that work has been on developing this statewide framework for building disaster recovery capabilities across the state. So my presentation today will talk a little bit about what the WRF is, the Washington Restoration Framework, and how it will work or intends to work with other jurisdictions such as the Thurston Regional Disaster Planning Group and other jurisdictions that might have developed or in the works of developing their own recovery plans. So starting out just very high level, what is recovery? I know you're all seasoned emergency managers, so you know this, but I just like to start out with this before we get into the weeds. So FEMA has their definition of recovery as the short-term and long-term efforts for the rebuilding and revitalization of affected communities. So the key thing to know, you've probably seen the recovery continuum. That's this graph here. It's been slightly adapted from FEMA when they introduced it back in 2011. But the key thing to note is that recovery activities do begin and overlap with response. The degree and the effectiveness of your response to a community is absolutely going to correlate to the effectiveness of the recovery of that community. So the faster you can set up a shelter, the faster you can get people out of a shelter and identify alternative housing, that's going to improve their recovery outcomes. So there's these overlapping transitions. It's not really a black and white transition between when response ends and when recovery begins. It really is kind of overlapping activities. So the Washington Restoration Framework is embedded throughout this whole process. We have it started within the state emergency management. It essentially begins with our ESF 14, our Emergency Support Function 14, which is our long-term recovery. And that's kind of building, that's the coordinating function that starts to gather information to basically determine whether we need to stand up specific areas of recovery, which we call recovery support functions. So I'll get into more details on that later, but we have our recovery starting within our state emergency operations center. And that's outlined in the Washington Restoration Framework. Most disasters do not meet the threshold of a federal declaration. And so that is another reason why we have built this disaster framework to essentially try to identify the programs and resources that are out there. Because it's so rare that we do get FEMA individual assistance. So it kind of just behooves us to all work together across state agencies and then with our federal, local, and tribal partners and those in non-government, VOADs, our voluntary organizations active in disaster, to really identify what resources are available. And there are a few existing recovery plans in the state, which is one of the reasons why we developed the statewide framework, is to kind of and I'll get into this in another slide, is to build on what has already been done in the state. So City of Seattle or King County might already have their disaster plan or framework in place, but many jurisdictions do not. And so the framework includes templates, considerations, things of that nature that can help be used as building blocks to making sure that we have a more resilient state by having more jurisdictions develop pre-disaster recovery. So just briefly, the state role in disaster recovery, and a lot of these can also correlate to what the city or county government's role is in a disaster. But certainly you want to identify the impacts to government services. So kind of that continuity of government and using your COOP plans, your continuity of operations plans, identifying what impacts are taking place in your community, establishing those recovery priorities early on and trying to work across agencies, across jurisdictions. We know that, and I'll probably mention this multiple times, disasters don't stop at the jurisdictional boundaries. And so we wanna make sure that we're working across those jurisdictions. Another role that the state plays is to communicate recovery assistance programs to the impacted communities. And then a key role is to be that conduit between our federal partners and local governments for any key recovery assistance programs, whether that's FEMA, the SBA, Small Business Administration, USDA, the Rural Development Programs, Housing and Urban Development. There's a whole slew of federal programs where they can come in and provide assistance depending on whether it's a presidentially declared disaster or not. And so we can help to share those resources out. So getting more into the weeds on what the Washington Restoration Framework is, it basically aims to do two things, and that's to improve interagency recovery collaboration, primarily at the state level, but we can certainly, when there's a disaster, we want to try to integrate and be flexible to work with whatever the affected community's recovery structure is. And then the second thing is to guide recovery planning efforts at all levels of government, primarily pre-disaster. It's definitely geared towards pre-disaster recovery planning activities. But again, there are some quite a bit of information within the Washington Restoration Framework that discusses case studies from other communities that have been affected by disasters within Washington State and how they've recovered. Some brief information on how to establish a long-term recovery group, what an unmet needs committee is. There's all sorts of different information in there that I think jurisdictions will find useful, both pre, during, and post-disaster. So it outlines the state activities within key recovery areas. Those are the recovery support functions. And it was developed in partnership with our local, state, federal, and tribal governments. We had a steering committee of around 15 to 20 individuals representing federal, state, local, and tribal government. Thurston County was on the steering committee for this framework. And then it also follows recovery best practices and lessons learned using the National Disaster Recovery Framework, which was released by FEMA in 2011 and I think re-released in around 2016. And that's FEMA was the one that originally came up with the recovery support function idea, the idea that there are common areas after disaster that just need a task force or group dedicated to trying to solve those issues. And so of course, housing is one of the biggest things that comes up after a disaster, even before a disaster, right? With the limited housing stock, housing, economic recovery, infrastructure. So those are what FEMA has established as key areas of recovery. And one of the key reasons why we developed this Washington Restoration Framework, it actually came out of the push and the drive to develop and establish this project came out of the 2015 wildfires. Although the state has been working on developing a statewide framework for a couple decades, the 2014 and 2015 Okanagan wildfires specifically really highlighted the need for jurisdictions and government to work collaboratively to support recovery of not the communities themselves and also at the individual level. And that was when we asked for FEMA assistance, individual assistance in 2014 and 2015, and we were denied. Okanagan successfully established a long-term recovery group. So that also highlighted the effectiveness of the long-term recovery group to support community recovery. And so some of those things have been captured in the Washington Restoration Framework, those lessons learned, so that we can have a much smoother process moving forward for other disasters. This is a framework, so it's not a plan by any means. You can think of it more as the architecture and the structure for coordinating across multiple levels of government, non-governmental partners, and agencies. And with this framework, we're not so much looking for jurisdictions to have complete 100% mirrored image at their level or consistency with it. But again, just to include, incorporate components of the Washington Restoration Framework as you develop your own plans, there's certain considerations of who you might want to reach out to, all the way down to what specific program a state agency or a federal program might have and how that would be implemented at your local level, whether it's through a local housing provider or an economic development organization. So the framework is more about ensuring that interoperability with differing structures, including flexibility and scalability. And that's something that I'll talk to on this slide. So the National Disaster Recovery Framework has a set of key guiding principles, and the Washington Restoration Framework has a very similar, they're not completely identical, but we also have guiding principles that we selected to guide the development of the framework and then also moving forward as we implement the framework for future disasters. So a lot of these are pretty self-explanatory, but again, these principles really guide the recovery actions and help to ensure a more successful recovery. We want the framework to be leverageable, so it could be used for all different types of disasters, not necessarily a catastrophic, and so that's also scalable. We want to be able to make it flexible so that if there's an impacted community and they don't have a housing recovery support function stood up, that we can still meet them where they're at and support them with any assistance we can provide. We want to recognize that recovery is subjective, so it starts and ends at the local level, and that really means that before the city and the county even request assistance from the state, before the state requests assistance from the feds, if needed, that recovery still will begin at that local level. And then long after, if there is any state or federal assistance provided, long after that, after FEMA has demobilized, state is demobilized, the community is still in charge of its own recovery and leading that its own recovery. It does take a whole community effort. So just recognizing that it's not just one agency, one organization, or one jurisdiction. We all need to collaborate together to leverage what limited resources we have in most disasters and make sure we're not duplicating efforts, but rather maximizing those resources. The framework is also built on working through existing authorities. So we're not assigning any new roles or responsibilities to any one agency. We're just, when we were very careful to spend a lot of time within each recovery support function. And then I think at the very beginning of the WRF, we have sections on what the primary authorities are for state government to support counties, what specific programs that agencies have, when they can be authorized and how can they be applied. So whether something requires an emergency proclamation from the governor or a disaster declaration, discussing the Stafford Act, which drives a lot of FEMA's individual and public assistance. And so the framework, this is a little bit of a busy slide, but a couple of things that you can take from this is the WRF is just one of many frameworks and plans that support the five mission areas within emergency management. That's the prevention, protection, mitigation, response, and recovery. And the regional and local plans are at the core of this planning diagram. So response and recovery starts and ends at that local level, but you might have comprehensive plans that include regional considerations. So you might have your metropolitan organization or metropolitan planning organization that is looking at, maybe they have a 2040 strategy plan or a 2050 vision for Thurston County. So when that disaster hits, it's important to revisit those plans, including a mitigation plan, and look at how those priorities have shifted, how the disaster's impacts have maybe shifted funding or areas that need to be revisited. Certainly that has been a major, COVID-19 has resulted in that across communities across the world in terms of using space for individuals who can now have the ability to telework, for example. So there's a re-examination of how we're using our built space, for example. So we want to make sure that individuals and actually communities are developing recovery plans that have components which make the most sense to their communities and to their regions. So it doesn't have to, and nor should it, perfectly align with the state's WRF, but you need to right size it and adjust it as needed. And I'll talk about that in just a minute in terms of how, giving some examples of how other communities in Washington state have established their recovery plans. So we have the, this is an example, a diagram that Paul asked me to touch on just for a minute, which is just kind of explaining recovery core capabilities and critical tasks. There's a lot of terminology out there and I get confused myself. So the way up high, you can kind of look at this diagram and read it from right to left. So way up high, there's the National Preparedness Goal, which is defined through the Presidential Policy Directive 8. It establishes 32 core capabilities across five mission areas. This is something at the presidential and federal level. Those five mission areas, one of them is, of course, recovery. Within that recovery mission area, there are specific core capabilities. These were introduced by FEMA a few years ago, and there's a predetermined connection between your core capabilities and critical tasks. It's you can kind of think of it as an umbrella of here is what we define economic recovery as, and here's what we define housing recovery as, so that when we're all, whether you're at a state, federal, state, local, tribal level, we can all agree that by and large, here is a very, very broad definition painted with a very broad paintbrush of what housing recovery is. And then you can get into a little bit more details with critical tasks. We've still tried to stick as much as possible with what FEMA has defined the critical tasks of. But if you're looking at, and you'll see at the bottom of this diagram, there's a purpose section, concept of operations, responsibilities. So this is kind of showing where in a recovery plan, if you're looking at the planning guidance that most emergency management follows across the nation, that's the Comprehensive Planning Guide 101, I believe it is. It's showing you where each section should fall. So from core capabilities, you go into critical tasks, and then where you have your activities, that's really the responsibility section. That's where you'll have your recovery support functions. And a lot of those activities have been identified through surveys, workshops, and other types of outreach. And that's what we did with the Washington Restoration Framework. For each recovery support function, we had surveys through SurveyMonkey, we had workshops, countless one-on-one meetings, we had focus groups with certain agencies to really try to identify what programs within each agency or nonprofit or organization, what those responsibilities and those activities are, and trying to group them into critical tasks and how it supports that core capability, be it housing, infrastructure, economic recovery, et cetera. So those activities are dictated or captured by the recovery support functions. And those recovery support functions are essentially the delivery method for accomplishing the critical tasks within that specific area, the core capability that supports the overall mission. So hopefully I didn't just muddy the waters anymore, but that's just kind of how we've outlined it within the framework. And so that's kind of the difference between the recovery support functions and core capabilities. And I just have a few more slides. I hope I'm not running over too much time. Paul, stop me if I'm going too fast or too slow.
You're good, Quinn.
Okay, good, thank you. So recovery support functions within Washington State for our WRF, we developed 8 recovery support functions. Now FEMA has introduced 6, and what they did is they have natural and cultural resources combined. We decided to split those up, and it really wasn't my decision. It wasn't EMD's decision. It was through workshops and surveys and discussions with our Department of Archaeology and Historic Preservation, with our Department of Natural Resources, with our State Historical Society. And they said, you know, that natural and cultural resources is really too big to lump into one thing. There's already more than enough to talk about just with cultural resources. And that's why we actually added on cultural and historic resources, because there is a distinction that our partners have made between those. And so we wanted to make sure that we called out historic resources. We also separated our health and social services. Again, that was a decision amongst DSHS, our Department of Social Health Services, and our Department of Health for the same reason. They said health and social is way too big of a issue or topic to lump in, especially for disaster recovery. So they wanted to split it out. They said that Department of Health has enough programs and resources that are in a mission that is entirely different from what our Department of Social and Health Services provides. And our Department of Social and Health Services works with social services organizations across the state. Our Department of Health works with our behavioral health and our local health jurisdictions across the state. So we decided to split those up. In any case, all of these recovery support functions, the 8 of them, were developed in partnership with state agencies. They're that coordinating structure before, during, and after. And then they focus on specific functions and share responsibilities for specific areas within those core capabilities. And I think most of you are probably familiar with recovery support functions at this point, since those are outlined in the in your regional framework, but I'll give a few examples too about how they've been used within Washington State. So I know this might be a little bit difficult to see with the coloring, but I wanted to try to show you that correlation of what I just described between state recovery support functions and federal recovery support functions. And then at the top, on the left-hand side, Community Recovery Task Force is an example of what the City of Seattle has in their framework, their pre-disaster recovery framework. So you can see they have added buildings and land use planning as an RSF number 7. They kept their health and social together. They kept natural and cultural together, but you can see they also added education to their health and social services. For the Washington Restoration Framework, version 2.0, I would definitely like to have much more involvement and more call outs on educational recovery considerations, since people are tied to where their kids are going to school, go to childcare. And we're seeing that right now in Whatcom County is, in fact, for their flooding disaster in November, one issue we're running into is that there's just no rental resources available in the area. And people are reluctant to move out of the area, even if it's 30 miles away, because they're going to have to be commuting because their kids are tied to that specific area. They have jobs in that area. And so doing a 30-minute commute every day one way, even if we're increasing rental assistance, even if we're trying to find reimbursements for gas mileage, it just is something that people are having an issue with. So education piece is certainly something I'd like to improve on in our WRF. It's kind of lumped in with our social services for right now. That center column, the county RSF, that's actually for King County's recovery framework. And so I tried to color code these obviously based off of how they might correlate across City of Seattle, King County, and then the state, just as in this example. You can see King County split up their infrastructure systems into transportation and utilities and infrastructure. And I'm sure they probably did that for reasons that have to do with the importance of King County as a primary transportation hub with I-5 and I-90, and just being that kind of that hub. And then probably City of Seattle and the number of people who are serviced in Seattle through the Seattle City Light and all of that. They also have a regional planning RSF. The one thing to note really quickly on the numbering of these, I think it was only King County that has the numbers of our, they have the RSFs actually numbered. RSF 1 is their community planning and capacity building, that's CPCB. The state does, and to my knowledge, City of Seattle doesn't either. They don't have them numbered. The state doesn't have them numbered in our WRF. I just did this to help correlate. So sometimes I've heard King County say like, oh yeah, we're working on RSF 4. And I'm like, I don't know what that really is. So we don't really put too much, we don't put too much thought into these numberings that we have. It's more just about how they correlate across each other. So I hope that helps to kind of show what some other communities are doing within Washington State. Now, outside of Washington State.
Hey, Quinn. Go ahead. Can I interrupt you there on King County RSF, the transportation, utilities, and infrastructure? For the transportation RSF, does that include roads, bridges, and transit?
That's include, my assumption.
Not just the services, but the transportation infrastructure as well, correct?
Yeah, that's my assumption, right.
And so yeah. Utilities and infrastructure, that would be like maybe wastewater and water utilities, electric utilities, natural gas, communications,
yeah.
All that.
Yeah, power, sewage, yeah. Mm-hmm. I would think so. And the City of Seattle's framework, I'm sure you've seen it, Paul, but if others haven't looked at their framework, I really highly recommend that you check it out, especially because at the back, I think it's the last page of all of their RSFs, they have just a list of questions of considerations for each of these RSFs. And I've used a lot of those to help I use those discussion points for workshops, for surveys, and as part of the baseboard and foundation for building on the state RSFs as well. So just two more slides here, just to give a few more examples. I did talk about the 2015 wildfires and just how that highlighted the importance of long-term recovery groups and the need to have a pre-disaster recovery framework. A few other examples here. In 2017, we had the Rattlesnake Ridge landslide. This was in Yakima County, or it was actually Union Gap right outside Yakima County, or yeah, the city of Yakima. And that was right after we had just finished the housing recovery support function. That was the first recovery support function that we had completed. Everything else was still in draft form. And we actually decided to activate the housing RSF. And we were there at the request of the county emergency management, because even though it was just about 75 or so people that were displaced, Yakima County just did not have the Yakima County EM did not have a recovery capacity to address the unmet needs that go beyond just the immediate relief stage of setting up a shelter, working with the Red Cross, you know, making sure people have gas cards or things like that. They realized that they needed some intermediate and long-term recovery assistance. And one of that was the biggest issue was housing. So we stood up our housing recovery support function. We had our local housing authorities were on the call. We had Department of Commerce. We had Yakima County Emergency Management. We had some tribal representation on the call. And Yakima Valley Continuity of Government, gonna mess up that acronym there. But what ended up happening is the Department of Commerce found some additional funds that they could provide to the local housing authorities to basically do some emergency hires of additional caseworkers for two social services, community organizations. Maybe one of them, I think, was a housing authority. It's been so long that they were basically able to hire on temporary caseworkers to specifically take on the load of trying to find housing for these individuals that were displaced. And we also reached out to our housing and urban development partners and USDA so that they could try to get them some letters of priority enrollment, basically, like if because some of these houses that were affected or threatened by this impending landslide were Section 8 housing. So they're able to get some emergency letters to basically get to the top of the list for Section 8 housing in the area. We don't anticipate having a housing RSF or any of the RSFs typically activated for that small of a disaster. That was a very hyper-local disaster, but it just gives an example that we were able to leverage some of the resources and connections that were established in the development of the RSF, and we were able to use that for that landslide issue. We also activated the housing RSF for the 2020 wildfires, and we're able to, again, try to identify what the impacts were and what resources were available, making sure that it's really about coordination and trying to find, making sure that everyone's on the same page, you know, sharing that situational awareness, understanding what resources are available, if there's some kind of threshold or trigger to have a certain program activated, making sure that we're all in the loop on that. In 2020, we did activate the economic RSF just briefly and supported some review. We helped review some of the guidance that was coming out or being developed by our unified coordination group at the state level in terms of economic impacts and considerations. There's some lessons learned with that in terms of how the economic RSF could have been leveraged more fully, but COVID-19 is just such a unique disaster in itself that I think that has led to some challenges with leveraging the RSFs, because there's just, I do expect the WRF and the RSFs to be used for any type of disaster, but as I was developing it, I certainly was not thinking that they would or could be used for a pandemic situation. And then most recently, we did activate the housing RSF again in 2021 for the November flooding, as well as 2022 in January, just briefly trying to engage with, again, our local housing authorities and our federal partners. So had Whatcom County, Skagit, or Clallam counties had a housing recovery support function already developed in place and stood up, then we wouldn't have had to do the extra legwork of trying to bring together the local housing authorities, the community action councils, and all of those across the county, within the city, within multiple cities, across the county, in the tribes. And so I think having that pre-disaster recovery plan in place and having those recovery support functions established, at the very least helps to bridge some of those connections and really expedite the recovery process. I think that was the last. I know that was a lot to go through. I hope I hit on most of the points you wanted me to, Paul. Happy to take any questions from you all. The disaster, the state's WRF is complete now, and the latest version is on our website, although it doesn't have the tag signature. So the Adjutant General for the Washington Military Department did sign it about a month ago, and our director is going to sign it as well. And so I don't have the version with the signature on it, the signatory page and all of that, but the bulk of the material is there. It is a very large document. And then it has, in fact, in the framework itself, it doesn't even have the recovery support functions. Those are broken out separately. But that's all available on our website, mil.law.gov/recovery. And you can find it down at the bottom of the page. It has case studies from real world disasters within Washington State and how those communities have recovered. So I talked to Jason Bierman over in Snohomish County for how, you know, some of the lessons learned from Oso landslide. I talked to Kitsap County after their 2018 Port Orchard tornado. And then I also talked to Walla Walla from their flooding in 2020. And then I think the fourth case study is from Carlene Anders with the 2014 and 2015 wildfires. So those case studies are at the very back of the WRF, kind of save the best for last, because I think that's something that could quickly be grabbed even in a disaster is if you're looking for key recovery points. Hey, what the heck did Oso do? And we're experiencing a flood. So what did Walla Walla County do for their flooding? And how did they coordinate with additional partners? Some of that information I've tried my best to capture that in the framework. So thanks. Happy to take any questions. As you can tell, I love talking about recovery. So if you don't cut me off, I'll be here all day. Thanks.
So any questions for Quinn on the Washington recovery framework?
I've just got a general question from my own knowledge. Are the terms recovery and restoration used interchangeably?
That's a really, really good point. We do differentiate them within the Washington restoration framework. And to be honest, I don't know how I've broken it up. I want to try to find that real quick for you. So I have tried to differentiate between the two. And I think there is a page within the framework where I've specifically described the differences. Off the top of my head, I do think that restoration is part of recovery. We want to have that response relief stage, and you're restoring basic services within the community in order to lead to a more full-fledged and effective recovery. So it's part of the whole recovery process.
Great. Thank you.
Good question.
Any others? Quinn, I have a question for you. With local communities developing their recovery support functions and identifying who their sort of key players and stakeholders are, what are you noticing in local plans as to what extent they are identifying state agencies as partners within their local recovery framework? Do you see that happening? Because we're a government town, so we kind of naturally think of, mm-hmm. you know, our state government agencies as partners. But in the context of the state's restoration framework, that's really sort of the state's purview and state's resources. But just trying to get a sense of, with us looking to put together our recovery support functions, yeah. Should we be focusing more on our local partners and nonprofits and community organizations and treating the state agencies as sort of like a tier two type partner?
Yeah, I see what you're getting at. And to answer your question, yes, I think that last part is probably the best approach. And within the state's recovery support functions, there's actually a section that talks about how that might look at the local level. So who you might want to consider reaching out to at the local level, because by and large, the state does not have any funds to support disaster recovery. It's very rare where the governor would authorize additional or special funds to an affected jurisdiction. But that being said, there are plenty of programs that do support relief response and long-term recovery, but a lot of those funds are channeled through state government, especially Commerce as a primary agency where you would have a lot of funds going through the Department of Commerce and end up going out to economic development organization or your housing authority or a coordinated entry, a community action council. And so I think it's important to reach out to those that would be more boots on the ground, so to speak, and have a more ingrained understanding of those connections within the community. But certainly, you know, obviously I don't think you would do this, but just a word of caution, if you are listing a state agency within your plan, making sure that you're reaching out to them and letting them know, hey, we'd like to get a little bit more information on who our point of contact would be for Department of Commerce if we were engaged with this RSF.
Great. Thanks, Quinn. And I see Sherry has a hand up.
Yeah, Quinn, one of the questions that has come up is funding for this. You know, we currently have a small amount of funding to be able to complete our work now. So the work that we're doing now in July, but as we kind of move forward, any information on like King County or even the state, what kind of funding did you guys utilize to move this forward?
Yeah, that is an excellent question. When I started at EMD, my position was funded through a past disaster. It was funded from the 2014 fires. And so it was just a project position, and we were able to basically say that we were able to expand the recovery coordinator position to say, hey, what the development of the framework is directly related to supporting the recovery of Okanagan County. And so it was a stretch, but we had the funds from our disaster response account at the state level. And so that's why that was that temporary position. At a county level, that's a really good question, and at a local level. And I can check with King County and City of Seattle. That might be something that we could bring up at our next WACOR meeting, the Coalition of Recovery Planners, which I know I need to get that back on our calendars. I'm trying to think of how there's a way to leverage any existing planning efforts that might be taking place, whether it's with a regional planning council or city planning council that isn't necessarily tied to emergency management, but they might be updating their comprehensive plans. Or if there's, you know, I think a lot of jurisdictions use the UASI grant money, the Urban Area Security Initiative. And so there might be more flexibility and opportunity to use those funds, but that is always the trickiest one, right? It's trying to find that funding to get a planner to support disaster recovery planning pre-disaster, and then post-disaster, how to get those positions funded and keep them funded. So if you have a disaster recovery manager or disaster recovery director, how are those positions being funded? You know, is it going to be city dollars, county dollars? Yeah, that's tricky.
Sandy?
Hey, Quinn. I really liked a slide that you presented that talked about looking at the federal level and how that drove the mission of the plan, and then how then on the left hand, you were talking about RSFs and how they were the ones that got the tasks implemented, and the tasks were part of the concept of operations. And I don't know if you remember which one that is, but I was hoping you could share it.
Yeah, share that specific graphic out with you where it has the core capabilities and the mission and all of that.
Yeah, I thought the explanation of that was really nice because it was talking about, it wasn't talking about the elements of the plan and how that drove things. It was talking about how the mission and the concept of operations and the tasks were driving the structure of the plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I'm happy to share that out. And when FEMA introduced the core capabilities, it's like as soon as we get our heads wrapped around some new terminology, then FEMA decides to change something all of a sudden. and introduce some new terminology. So that one took me a while to wrap my head around. And there was a lot of pushback from the state as well as jurisdictions in terms of not having the flexibility. Of course, we can do whatever we want, but FEMA highly recommended that we stick with the language of that core capability. And even the critical tasks, although we've added some language to the critical tasks to expand upon access and functional needs for a few of the critical tasks. But we did end up coming around to trying to keep those core capabilities and leaving them alone as much as possible, because that way, whether you're at the federal, state, or local level, we are all on the same page of what it means for housing recovery. And you can expand and have your own definition and bring in the agencies and organizations to meet that core capability, but that way we're all on the same page of at least at the high level of what housing recovery or economic recovery looks like. And then we can look for that in the plans too, as we're developing plans that are able to kind of integrate with one another.
Well, Quinn, thank you for your time. Quinn is a valuable resource. If questions come up, we can certainly reach out to Quinn for more information. So in the interest of time and the remaining items on the agenda, I'd like to move on. And Quinn, thank you for joining us. You're welcome to stick around, or if you got to drop off for other work, we understand. So thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you. I do have to drop off, but thank you all. Really appreciate it. Happy to return if you'll have me back, if you need like a focus area on housing recovery or something and what we did at the state. Happy to do that. And Casey, I know I do owe you some surveys and workshop examples of what we use to develop components of the WRF. So I'll be sure to send those your way when I can. Thank you all.
Thanks, great. Quinn. See ya.
I'll send out Quinn's presentation after the meeting so folks can take a look at that.
Okay, is everyone seeing the charter and project background screen? Is that showing up on the share screen? Is that a yes or? Okay, great.
Yes.
Okay, so I want to give credit to Casey. Casey drafted the charter. So as a way of reference, the interlocal cooperative agreement for the Disaster Recovery Council, one of the six objectives specified developing a charter and bylaws. And so we interpreted that as let's create a charter that includes the bylaws, basically your operating procedures. And this is fairly standard information, but today we're looking for your approval and action on this. Casey sent this out to you in advance. This is really just talking about the overview of the project, who are the members and alternate members, schedule, how we communicate, just meeting norms, decision making, fairly basic information. We wanted to keep it short and simple, and we hope that we achieve that. There's a couple areas that are highlighted that we wanted to, that are kind of discussion points I want to get your feedback on. Regarding the project overview and as it relates to the membership, according to the interlocal cooperative agreement, was those signatory agencies to the Disaster Recovery Council agreement. And because of the amount of funding we have and the limited budget, we decided at this phase of our planning process, we were going to keep it confined to the county and the cities and the tribes. The tribes really have not opted in. However, Lacey, and I'm not trying to create this to make this awkward or anything, but Lacey, well, it agrees in principle to the what's included in the cooperative agreement. Lacey chose at this time not to sign it, but is interested in participating in the process. So we just thought it was important to point that out at this time. And so I don't know if Lacey or any of the members have any issue with this, but because it relates to the membership of the Disaster Recovery Council, we wanted to make sure we weren't overlooking it or anything, or just for total transparency if another, say, jurisdiction or a special purpose district wanted to join the DRC at this time. We don't think we would object to that. But with the spirit and intent of the agreement, it did specify the signatory agencies. So any thoughts on that? Is it fine as we present it? Is there anything we need to modify to that? Let me just see, if you're okay with how it's stated, let's see a thumbs up.
I just had a question, Paul, kind of related to that. Now you mentioned this kind of, you know, is going to kind of cover some bylaw type issues too. And I don't want to get hung up in process, but, you know, with this group, are there decisions that are going to have to be made that are going to require like a quorum, or, you know, how will that work? If there aren't enough people at the meeting, or, you know, if there is, I appreciate the dispute resolution mechanisms in here, and I hope everybody gets the consensus, but if you don't get the consensus, how are those decisions going to be made then?
Yeah, fair question. I think as staff, we should probably do some more reaching out for each meeting to make sure that we're going to have a majority attendance of the representatives so that we can reach consensus with the majority of the members. I would say if we have an action item where members are missing and the DRC doesn't feel like it's in a position to take action because of lack of quorum, that's something we can postpone to the next meeting until we do have a quorum. That would be my suggestion. But we're looking for overall consensus. And if we, you know, as you pointed out, Brian, if we don't reach consensus, we kind of describe a process by which we can overcome those conflicts. So the next thing, this is pretty straightforward as far as the schedule. We're proposing just setting a date that is fixed on everybody's calendars for the duration of the project now through July. So we're looking at the third Friday each month from 10 to 11 a.m. as a proposed standing meeting time. Does that work for most people? Is that an issue? And if for some reason people can't make it, we're hoping you provide an alternate. And so you can see on the membership, we do have primary representatives listed and alternates. So not all the jurisdictions have offered up an alternate. So that's something we would like to fill in the gaps if possible.
Paul, that looks good to me here at City of Olympia.
Great, thanks, Todd. And so that was it. So we're kind of looking, did we generally get this right? Does anybody have heartburn with what's in here? Does this seem appropriate for the phase of the project we're in now, knowing that this charter can be amended at a future time when necessary?
Yeah, I mean, just my input is, it seems like for this process, this seems very, like a very reasonable approach. You know, any, you know, formal decisions or anything, we'll have to go back to each jurisdiction anyway. So this, for this planning process, this seems very reasonable to me.
Anybody else have comments? And certainly, you know, if anyone doesn't feel comfortable taking action to approve this today, Casey and I can entertain any suggestions or edits that you want to email to us later on. But today we would like to see if this is in a sufficient state that this is your working charter from here on through the end of this phase. So let's just see a quick hand raise to see who's in favor of approving this.
I have a quick question for you.
Sure, Sandy, go ahead.
Does it say anywhere in there that the meetings are open to other agencies in the public.
We're trying to conform with the Open Public Meetings Act. So we think that these meetings should be open to the public. And that reminds me, I should highlight, we are developing a website. I would expect that website to be up in the next week, and we will share that link with you. That website will be fairly rudimentary as far as posting our agenda items with the dates and meeting materials, as well as some links to resources like FEMA National Disaster Recovery Framework, the Washington State Recovery Framework, and other resources that we think would be useful, as well as anything that you might propose that we include, and also include any meeting notes that we share with you.
That sounds great.
And so we can look through I don't recall if we explicitly state that in here, but we, with your approval, we could just amend that in and have a statement that all DRC meetings are open to the public and other members of the community. Stephen, I see you have your hand up.
Yeah, are you, is it your intent to continue with the Zoom meetings, or do you intend to have in-person meetings in the future?
At least for the foreseeable future, we'll continue doing Zoom meetings. Since these are only an hour long, I think it's just really convenient to do them online so that we can avoid that travel time. I would say that future disaster recovery planning efforts, we'd probably want to, as it's safe to do so, shift towards some in-person meetings, especially when we're doing broader community outreach, and possibly in the future, as funding becomes available, expanding that to do some open houses to engage the public at large.
Yeah, well, I was just wondering, because my third Fridays of the month are pretty full of meetings right now. That's kind of what I do on the third Fridays.
So does the Zoom work better for you then, Stephen?
Well, except for the fact that I despise Zoom meetings, yes, it works better.
Point taken. Sandy?
I was just thinking about what Brian was mentioning about having a quorum. It doesn't look like that's really required in here, but it is possible to do decisions through email, an email correspondence, if that's an option.
Yeah, we could take a poll if members felt like they wanted to hear back from Tenino and Rainier on this to determine their comfort level. We could push this out to an email decision, and then report back to you at our next meeting. So that is an option.
Personally, I'm comfortable just making the decision today. You know, it seems like it needs to keep moving forward.
Okay. So with that, I would just be looking to hear a motion from you to approve this. And if you want, we can add a line in here about the DRC meetings being open and available to the public.
Sure, I'll move. We approve the, make sure I title it right, proposed charter for the Disaster Recovery Council with the amendments as suggested.
Thank you, Brian. So Brian made a motion. Is everybody fine with this? Yes, let's see a thumbs up. Okay, thank you. I'll take that as majority approval. So thanks for that. So we're at the end of our hour. If I may, I'd just like to quickly go through my slides on your work program. I don't think this will take me more than 5 minutes if I can get you to stick around. Let me get here into presentation mode.
Paul, can I just ask you a question real quick?
Yeah.
So since the city at this time has decided not to sign, does that, would I be discluded from any of the decision-making and voting process?
No, I don't think so. I think what we, my sense in writing this charter and the point of clarifying that is we really want Lacey to be participating in this process at this stage in time. So we would like to give you, you know, equal voting and approval along with the other members.
Okay.
And we're hoping Lacey will come around at some point and reconsider his decision.
I think they just wanted more information. So that's what we're kind of looking at.
Okay. So I'm going to try to get this launched. Do people see the presentation? Okay, so real quick, 2022 work plan. This is kind of trying to lay out for you what we intend to do between now and July. This is really sort of the abbreviated version of what's in the interlocal cooperative agreement as far as your objectives. You've created your charter, we have a meeting schedule, we have participants recognized, we can check that number one off the list. Congratulations on that. Next is establishing a work plan for Recovery Manager's Office and Recovery Task Force. That's sort of the leadership part of this. Defining any additional necessary agreements and staffing needs for the RMO, that's the Recovery Manager's Office and Recovery Task Force. Evaluating opportunities and recommendations for establishing and operationalizing those leadership and governance functions for the disaster recovery framework, and updating the disaster recovery framework with recovery support functions. I think that's going to be our real focus right there, that fifth bullet, as well as identifying next steps for disaster recovery planning. Just to reiterate kind of what Quinn said, all disasters are local, and local governments have primary responsibility for leading disaster recovery. Having a pre-disaster recovery plan can really help to shorten the recovery and restoration process. But we're looking with this plan, it's important to identify the partners that would be involved who can provide some recovery capabilities to assist communities here in Thurston County, organizing that framework and operationalizing it, connecting it to existing plans. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. We already have some good plans in place and some agreements that we can capitalize on and leverage with disaster recovery. But your role here, it goes without saying that the Disaster Recovery Council right now, you are holding the torch, so to speak, on leading recovery planning for your communities. Because of the scope of what we're doing right now, we're really not taking a whole community approach at this time, although we are trying to reach out to stakeholders and reach a variety of perspectives and voices through our disaster recovery framework work program. So this is all about planning. This slide here, this is out of the National Disaster Recovery Framework that tries to illustrate the role of pre-disaster recovery planning and its relationship to other plans, so that this pre-disaster recovery plan really starts to establish those recovery policies and build that recovery framework, which is circular and requiring us to our communities to look at other related plans, such as our hazard mitigation plan, our overarching comprehensive and strategic plans, economic development strategies, climate adaptation plans, and other plans. So this slide here, this is straight out of FEMA's Disaster Recovery Planning for Local Governments guidebook. I really just wanted to share this with you because this really is giving an illustrative timeline for how pre-disaster recovery planning, that the extent, the level of detail and the work that would be required, that this typically is a year plus activity. What we're doing is really just taking a small chunk of this with the Disaster Recovery Council. its work. So that local disaster recovery planning guidance identifies six steps that I'm outlining here in this slide on the left. On the right is how that translates into our work program. So forming a planning team, we've kind of done that with this phase. We have the Disaster Recovery Council, you, Thurston County Emergency Management, and TRPC are helping to lead the Disaster Recovery Council. The Hazard Mitigation Plan is really our tool for understanding what our risks and potential hazards are. And as part of our Hazard Mitigation Plan update, we're going to be doing some loss estimation scenarios that can then help inform what sorts of potential disasters we could encounter that could shape recovery policies. Identifying goals and objectives, we'll really be doing that through drafting new and as well as updating the existing recovery support functions. What we're talking about with the new recovery support functions that TRPC will be working with you to tackle are infrastructure and utilities, which rolls in transportation, natural resources, and cultural and historic resources. So those are the three that we'll be focusing on. And as time allows, we'll be taking information from the Integrated Emergency Management course after action review and improvement plan to update those existing RSFs and probably getting to some feedback through email channels and networking with partners to make sure that they're in a state that continues to move us forward. Developing the plan. So we will start to take a preliminary look at looking at the leadership and governance and decision-making processes for disaster recovery. The draft recovery framework we have right now looks at a multi-jurisdictional approach with this decision-making body referred to as a recovery task force, and with a sort of a executive director level role as a local disaster recovery manager. We'd want to look at opportunities if we were to take some approach or model based on that, how it would be scalable. So if it's multiple jurisdictions that are impacted, a multi-jurisdictional leadership entity would be warranted. But if it's a highly localized impact, we'd want to scale that. So it's really that community in control of making decisions with support from planning partners and other community partners. Preparing, reviewing, adopting the plan. We'll be documenting recommendations that come out of your work here over the next 6 months, producing a report that is really highlighting next steps and follow-up recommendations for future phases for pre-disaster recovery work. And implementing and maintaining the plan, that's really going to be your role in deciding how you want to continue to meet, how you would be staffed, and looking out, seeking other funding opportunities to continue this work program to start taking that whole community approach and adhering to that FEMA planning guidance for pre-disaster recovery planning. So in terms of a timeline, in March, we'll start discussing with you our strategy for developing those recovery support functions. We've already drafted a list of potential stakeholders who would be involved with that, and we're drafting communications to send out to folks. We want to develop a questionnaire or survey that we can share to get their feedback, and then do some type of virtual meeting with those stakeholders for each individual RSF to get their take on sort of the takeaways and what we're thinking are going to be the themes coming out of those questionnaires for those recovery support functions. And we'll be looking to King County, Seattle's, and the Washington Restoration Framework surveys and questionnaires as some inspiration to inform ours and making sure that they kind of get to the core capabilities as applicable to our region. In April, we'll probably just have some conversations with you and brainstorming some models for what a local disaster recovery manager and recovery task force could look like I really think we'll just be touching on that. I'm hesitant to make any significant promises that we're going to reach any conclusions on there, but at least it will help to inform some recommendations that you make for future work on revisiting that issue. Because ultimately you're going to want to take these recommendations and review them and share them back with your councils, boards, and commissions for their feedback and their level of comfort on them. So that would inform a final report that we hope to share with you by July. That would be something that you could take back to your legislative bodies for discussion. So that's really what we're aiming to do. That's a lot, we think, to cover. And I think it will be a challenge for us to cover all of this. But I think for Casey and I, our real focus is going to be diving into these recovery support functions, because I think as COVID-19 illustrated the economic and health impacts, it was those Thurston County Public Health and working with health agencies, as well as the work that Thurston Strong did with working on economic recovery, that highlighted that those recovery support functions were really the sort of the where recovery was happening. So we want to build that capacity with those other recovery support function areas. So any questions on that?
Paul, not really a question. I was just wondering if you could share that brief presentation as well.
Yeah. And our plan is all of our meeting materials as well as presentations will go up on that website when it's available. So that's something you can go back to as a resource and find it, as well as share links with your colleagues and policymakers.
Appreciate it. Thanks.
Yeah. Any other thoughts? Words of encouragement? Okay. So that is all we have. We will get our notes up. We will make those adjustments to the charter and share that updated charter with you. And as soon as that website is online, we'll share that link, and you should be able to find the resources that we've been discussing. Casey, anything else?
Nope, you covered it. I think the website maybe next week or the week after. So if it's looking like it's not ready, I'll send out the PowerPoints and charter and summary notes just via email so everyone has that.
Sherry, do you have anything else?
Yep, I'm good.
Great.
I have one thing real quick. I do have a backup person or backup for me. So do you want me to email that to you, Casey, or who do I email that? Yep. Okay.
That would be great if you could send their name and contact information.
Okay, I can do that.
Thanks, Ed. Okay, thank you, everybody. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Paul.